Good evening, everybody, and welcome to this edition of History and Highballs. We're so glad that you're joining us for this evening's program, History and Highballs, Grove Park Inn. My name is Stacy, and I handle adult education here at the museum. So whenever you sign up for one of these History and Highballs programs, you and I will virtually get to spend the evening together listening to some incredible stories about North Carolina places and people and what makes our state so special. Tonight is just one of many exciting virtual offerings available through MOH. So if you'd like to learn more about our History at Home initiative, we invite you to head over to the museum's website at www.ncmuseumofhistory.org. This is also where you can learn more about shopping in our wonderful museum shop, including Bruce Johnson's books, Tales of the Grove Park Inn, as well as An Unexpected Guest, and a lot of other Asheville related wonderful things, including a Grove Park Inn puzzle. The museum's website is also where you can learn more about becoming an associates member. Our associates and foundation provide crucial funding and support to the museum, which in addition to many other things, helps make programming like this evening's event possible. We would like to take this opportunity to thank those of you who graciously donated funds towards this evening's program. We do our best to keep our programs free to attend, but there are costs associated with keeping our series going, and we just continue to be so grateful of your generous support of the museum. A few quick housekeeping items for this evening. We ask that you please keep your mics muted throughout the entirety of the program, and we invite you to type any questions that you have for our guest speaker into the chat function located at the bottom center of your screen. At the end of the program, our adult programs intern, Alexandra, will ask our speaker as many of your questions as time allows. All right, so it's my honor to introduce this evening's speaker, author and historian Bruce E. Johnson. Johnson, who moved to Asheville in the 1980s, wrote and directed tonight's film tour, and is the author of Built for the Ages, A History of the Grove Park Inn, published in 1991, Tales of the Grove Park Inn, published in 2013, and Grove Park Inn, Arts and Crafts Furniture, published in 2009, as well as a novel, An Unexpected Guest, based on the inn's infamous Pink Lady. His love for the Grove Park Inn, along with experience as a collector of arts and crafts, style furniture, and pottery, led him to organize the National Arts and Crafts Conference and Antique Show in 1988. It just celebrated its 34th year. Welcome, Bruce. Thanks so much for joining us this evening.
Thank you, Stacy. It's my pleasure to be here, even though I'm not there with you. I'm here in my office outside Asheville, but very, very glad to do this. This is something that I've been accustomed to doing live at the Grove Park Inn for different groups. So it's great to be doing it without having to travel very far. As Stacy mentioned, we're going to show tonight a brief video tour that I made last year because of COVID, our 34th National Arts and Crafts Conference, which is held at the Grove Park Inn every February, the third weekend of each February for the past 34 years. Of course, we couldn't do it live because of the COVID restrictions. So we did it virtually during the entire month of February. And to introduce the Grove Park Inn to those attendees who hadn't been there before, we made a brief video. And so we're going to show it here this evening to kind of give you either a review of what it looks like inside the Grove Park Inn, because I know many of you have been over to Asheville to see it at some point in your lifetime. And for those of you who haven't, it's a little bit of a teaser to entice you to come over at some point in time. There will be references in there to the National Arts and Crafts Conference. We didn't record this as a sales pitch for you tonight. It was, like I said, recorded for those people attending our virtual conference in February. And now we are planning our live 35th National Arts and Crafts Conference, which will take place the third weekend of February, which will be February 18th through 20th. It's a three-day educational seminar, conference. We have seminars in the evenings and mornings. We do house tours with the Preservation Society. We have demonstrations, and then we have a selling show. We have antique dealers from across the country. We have contemporary craftspeople, artists and artisans making things in the arts and crafts style. And then we have representatives from magazines, book publishers, and the like, nonprofit organizations. It is the national gathering place for people who have an interest in arts and crafts. I would encourage you to come over. People can come over and just shop the afternoon shows. It's not necessary to either stay at the Grove Park Inn or to even sign up for the conference events. If you just want to come over and see the wonderful array of antiques and new works, that will all be taking place in February. The website is arts-craftsconference.com. And with that, I'll stop talking for a little bit. Stacy will show the video, and then I'll be more than glad to answer your questions and tell a few stories about some of the famous guests who stayed at the Grove Park Inn. Resort hotel in the world, and it lived up to its reputation, attracting such celebrities as Henry Ford and Thomas Edison and presidents Coolidge, Wilson, Roosevelt, and the Obamas, who came twice. Now, since then, the inn has had two additions added to the main inn, which brings the number of rooms up to 512. It also now has two ballrooms, four restaurants, several meeting rooms and shops, making it the ideal location for our annual National Arts and Crafts Conference. Edwin Wiley Grove was a millionaire pharmaceutical manufacturer who had homes in St. Louis, St. Petersburg, and here in Asheville, where by 1913, he had accumulated more than 1,000 acres of land on and around Sunset Mountain on the north side of the city. City officials convinced Grove that a resort hotel built on Sunset Mountain would be an instant success, as the city had already established a reputation as a haven for tourists wanting to escape the summer heat in the south and the harsh winters in the north. Grove's son-in-law, Frederick Loring Seeley, seen here on the right with his friend, Secretary of State, and three-time presidential candidate, William Jennings Bryan, offered to design the hotel and to serve as the general contractor overseeing construction. Seeley suggested that they utilize the numerous deposits of granite, rocks, and boulders found on Grove's extensive holdings to build the walls of the six-story hotel. Without the aid of forklifts or cranes, the men hauled rocks down the mountain in wagons, then wheeled them up long ramps before lifting them into place. Fred Seeley left explicit instructions for his stonemasons. First, he wanted the rocks picked up off the ground, not blasted out of a quarry. Second, he wanted them to have their natural appearance. So if there was any moss on them, he wanted that left alone. And finally, he had them push all the mortar to the back so the rocks would be visible and not the mortar. And that was in keeping with Frank Lloyd Wright's theory of organic architecture, that the structure should be built of the mountain, not on the mountain. At the heart of the hotel is the Great Hall, which was far more than just a typical hotel lobby. At either end, two twin fireplaces dominated the room and its 30-foot ceiling. Inspired by the Old Faithful Inn at Yellowstone National Park, the fireplaces looked like they could have heated the entire hotel. But in truth, the Grove Park Inn featured every modern advancement in heating, plumbing, refrigeration, and entertainment for its guests, many of whom stayed for several days, if not weeks, at a time. After the inn opened in 1913, Fred Seeley leased it back from his father-in-law and provided his guests with every available form of entertainment, from silent movies, lectures, and recitals here in the Great Hall to an indoor swimming pool, a three-lane bowling alley, and pool tables downstairs in the recreation room. Outdoors, they could go hiking, ride horses, take automobile tours, play tennis and golf, or simply soak in the afternoon sun on the open terraces.
Long before he arrived in Asheville, Fred Seeley had met Elbert Hubbard at the Roycroft campus in East Aurora, New York, where he placed an order for furniture for his home. When it came time to furnish the Grove Park Inn, Fred Seeley again turned to his friends in the Roycroft shops. For the Great Hall, he ordered this custom Roycroft 8-foot tall clock, which craftsman Victor Toothaker designed and for which he most likely made the hammered copper face and hardware. Seeley also ordered 400 Roycroft oak dining room chairs, each bearing the GPI initials, along with several corner cupboards and sideboards, along with hundreds of copper lighting fixtures and lamps made in the Roycroft Copper Shop. The Great Hall has undergone a number of changes, but still retains its arts and crafts character and heritage. Gone are the rocks around each of the six massive columns, but they've recently been encased and illuminated by contemporary craftsmen working in the arts and crafts style. The original wicker furniture has been replaced with a comfortable blend of contemporary furniture, quality reproductions, and arts and crafts antiques beneath the Roycroft chandeliers. And it never seems to matter what season it is, people still love to cozy up next to one of the two twin fireplaces to enjoy an evening in the Great Hall. During its brief history, the Roycroft Furniture Shop is believed to have made five grandfather clocks. The Grove Park Inn has two in its collection, the 8-foot clock and the 6-foot clock, which I believe Fred Seeley ordered for his personal office. I think this one was made around 1917 after Victor Toothaker, who designed the 8-foot clock, had left the Roycroft shops. Not only did Fred Seeley order Roycroft furniture and lamps for the hotel, but he also sold Roycroft items in the gift shop, originally located in one corner of the Great Hall. The hotel is undoubtedly responsible for sending hundreds of Roycroft books, lamps, and copper items home with guests from across the country for nearly 30 years. While he was no craftsman, Elbert Hubbard loved creating mottos so much that he had many of them printed on cards and sold in gift shops. Fred Seeley also loved inspirational slogans, so much in fact that he had several of his favorites painted on the rocks inside the Great Hall. While we could spend hours more here in the Great Hall, I'm going to let you do that exploring on your own when you come back for the next National Arts and Crafts Conference. Right now, we're going to go up to the third floor Palm Court, part of the original main inn, so you can see why it is that so many of our attendees make the reservation months in advance to get one of the rooms in the main inn. As he was designing the Grove Park Inn, Fred Seeley insisted that the stonemasons make each of the Great Hall fireplaces large enough to include an elevator shaft leading up to the third through the sixth floors where the guest rooms were located. Both elevators have remained in service ever since 1913. We are actually standing right now on the ceiling of the Great Hall, which is two stories tall, which means we're now on the third floor of the Grove Park Inn. This is called the Palm Court, and that's because since 1913, these four oak planters have been here, and they've always had palm trees planted in them. And that's why Fred Seeley called this the Palm Court. It's a wonderful, quiet retreat when you're ready to escape all the noise of the Great Hall. Standing here, it is not hard to imagine what it felt like staying at the Grove Park Inn in 1913. The Palm Court still has its original Roycroft ceiling lights, and the area has been furnished with accurate arts and crafts and old hickory reproduction furniture. Over the years, the original arts and crafts stencil was painted over, but it has more recently been documented and duplicated by a local artist who spent nearly an entire summer working on it from scaffolding. The Palm Court is also considered the home of the Pink Lady, the inn's resident ghost. She occasionally appears to guests here as a young woman in a pink gown, furthering the theory that she fell to her death from one of the balconies overlooking the Palm Court. Although the Roycrofters were unable to supply all the furniture for the 150 guest rooms in time for Fred Seeley's deadline, they did create enough bedroom pieces for the well-respected White Furniture Company of Mebane, North Carolina, to take over the contract and furnish all the guest rooms based on Roycroft designs. The Roycroft Copper Shop, however, was able to make more than 1,500 signed drawer pulls for all the bedroom furniture, leading some people to incorrectly assume that a dresser or vanity made by the White Furniture Company had been made by the Roycrofters. Today, the Main Inn rooms still retain their arts and crafts character, even though they now consist of a combination of original antiques and recent reproductions. Room 441 was where author F. Scott Fitzgerald lived for much of 1936 and 1937, while his wife Zelda was kept at a mental sanitarium a mile away. Fitzgerald had one of his many disastrous affairs with a married woman staying at the Grove Park Inn, whom he spotted reading his novel, The Great Gatsby. Reportedly, his pickup line was, "Why read the book when you can have the real thing?" After Fred Seeley's death in 1942 and World War II, the 40-year-old Grove Park Inn fell out of favor and fashion. In 1953, Texas billionaire Charles Sammons purchased the hotel. He and his wife, Elaine, shown here with one of their managers, began a restoration and expansion program, including the 1984 Sammons Wing. During the Sammons era, which lasted until 2009, the management at the Grove Park Inn made a concerted effort to purchase original vintage arts and crafts antiques and to supplement them with quality reproductions for the hallways and meeting rooms. They even went so far as to track down this original 1913 pool table, which had been in the Grove Park Inn when it opened. The President's Lounge at the end of the Sammons Wing hallway offers guests another quiet spot, this one with a panoramic view over downtown Asheville with the Blue Ridge Mountains as a backdrop. It also offers a great view of the west side of the Main Inn, as well as the Vanderbilt Wing, which was built in 1988 and also furnished with a blend of antiques and new works in the arts and crafts style. This concludes our brief tour of the Grove Park Inn, but I hope you'll come in person for our next National Arts and Crafts Conference, when you'll have 3 days to fully explore what has become known as the finest arts and crafts resort hotel in the world. Thanks for watching.
Well, Alexandra, if you can hear me, if there are any questions that people typed into the chat room, we can answer those now.
Absolutely. Thank you very much, Mr. Johnson. That was excellent. So the first question comes from Patricia Blackwell, who asked, why did they order furniture from New York instead of from North Carolina craftsmen?
Well, actually did end up ordering it from North Carolina craftsmen. Fred Seeley was from New Jersey, and he was reluctant to believe that the craftsmen in North Carolina could meet his standards. So he started by ordering from the Hubbards, the Roycrofters in East Aurora, because he'd ordered from them before. However, as I pointed out in the video, the Roycrofters were too small of a shop to make all the furniture he needed for 150 guest rooms. So he did turn to the White Furniture Company over in Mebane, not too far from where many of you are. And the White Furniture Company made fabulous arts and crafts furniture, the majority of which is still in use in the main inn rooms. So it did end up being a North Carolina project with North Carolina furniture in it.
And the next question is from JJS, who asked who the architect was. They missed the beginning of the program and didn't hear the name.
Well, it's because there was no name. Interestingly enough, E.W. Grove, he would say that one of the reasons why he was a multimillionaire was because he was a bit of a cheapskate. Instead of hiring an architect, he held a contest in which he invited architects from across the country to send him plans for the hotel. And then he rejected all of them. And then his son-in-law, Fred Seeley, who was not an architect, he was a pharmacist, sat down with the plans and started doing a little bit of creative cut and paste. And he literally cut apart two or three different of the sets of architectural drawings to come up with his own idea of what the Grove Park Inn should look like. However, he still needed to have an architect sign off on it. And so Fred Seeley hired an itinerant architect by the name of McKibben out of Georgia. But for years, Fred Seeley took credit for the design of the Grove Park Inn, and he oftentimes listed himself as the architect. To be historically correct, Fred Seeley designed the Grove Park Inn, but McKibben from Atlanta, Georgia, was truly the man who drew up the drawings. So it was more of a collaboration between Fred Seeley, a number of unknown architects, and McKibben, who put together the Grove Park Inn.
Thank you. And Linda Sweeney asks, when is the next Arts and Crafts Conference?
February the 18th through the 20th in 2022, 7 or 8 months away. But in fact, we've probably got about 1/3 of the inn is already sold out. It's a pretty amazing group, the arts and crafts enthusiasts. If you love arts and crafts, you're probably smiling as I tell you, it's no surprise that some people sign up a year in advance. We have some people who've attended over 30 of our 35 years. Many of them call up early so they can stay in the same room that they stayed in prior years.
So a few people in the chat are interested in hearing more about the Pink Lady and the other resident ghosts of the Grove Park Inn.
The Pink Lady is one of my favorite people to talk about that I've almost never met. The inn is haunted. There's no doubt about that. I've read enough of the security reports dating back into the 1930s, back at a time when it wasn't popular to be haunted, to believe that she really does exist. And I've talked to staff and to guests who've actually seen her. She always appears as a young woman in a flowing pink gown. She actually sometimes appears as someone in the flesh and blood. And she's a mischievous young woman. Never an evil, scary ghost. She's one more apt to play tricks on people. In some instances, she will be seen going into a restroom, and then when somebody waits for her to come out, she never does, and they go in and there's nobody there. She's been known to cause all the lights to come on and off at the same time. She will, cause people to, one of my favorite stories is a young couple who rented two rooms side by side, put their children to sleep in one room, and they were in the second room in the afternoon. And when they went in to wake up the small children, the children asked, "Where's the nice lady in the pink dress?" So she does exist. I personally have not seen her. I've had a couple of close encounters with her, but she does exist. We know nothing about who she was or how she came to her death. Those sort of things would not have been hard to cover up back in the 30s when something like that happened. Fred Seeley was the sort of general manager that if a young woman did fall to her death, he would make sure it stayed out of the newspapers. So it's no surprise that we don't have any idea who her identity is, but she is there. She is still there. I would say she probably makes an appearance two or three times a year that we know of. We've had people who have checked into certain rooms then asked to be moved because they feel like the room is haunted. She primarily stays in and around the Palm Court in the main inn. So if you are desirous of seeing her, make sure you ask for a room, preferably on the fifth floor of the Palm Court. It's where she shows up the most often.
The next question is about the golf course. Was it originally part of the inn in 1913? And I had a few people asking about that in the chat about the origins of the golf course.
Yeah, the golf course, ironically, is actually older than the Grove Park Inn. It started out in the early 1900s as the Asheville Country Club golf course. And the irony was that E.W. Grove never was able to buy it back. And what happened was that E.W. Grove became a major stockholder in the golf course so that he could arrange for his guests to stay, who stayed at the Grove Park Inn, to play the course at a discounted rate. And the course is famous for being designed by Donald Ross. And in fact, if you know anything about golf course design, you know that Donald Ross is considered the father of golf course architects. And there are actually three courses in Asheville designed by Donald Ross. And so that, and this was done in the 1920s. It was not the original course, but they hired Donald Ross to come in and redesign it. So it is considered a Donald Ross golf course. Several years ago, they had the golf course renovated, I guess you would say, back to the way that Donald Ross would have liked it. And then the Grove Park Inn currently does own it. In the 1960s, 1970s, they arranged to buy it from the Asheville Country Club. So it is now officially part of the Grove Park Inn. And the Asheville Country Club got a new golf course out on the north side of Asheville. So the Grove Park Inn currently owns the golf course, but it is actually older than the Grove Park Inn.
Thank you. This next question comes from Brian, who asks if you have a most interesting story about the Grove Park Inn.
Well, there have been a lot of famous guests who stayed at the Grove Park Inn. And the easiest one to tell a short story about is President Franklin Delano Roosevelt. He arrived at the Grove Park Inn in 1936 when he was running for re-election. But since that, around that time, he had been stricken with polio. And when he arrived at the Grove Park Inn, he was in an open touring car, and his son, one of his sons, accompanied him on these campaign trips. And what's remarkable when we think about it today is that when it came time for FDR to get out of the car, which of course he couldn't do on his own, all the photographers agreed not to take any pictures. And so what happened is that FDR's son literally lifted the president out of the car, put him in the wheelchair, wheeled him in up to his room, and there were no pictures taken by the press of any of that happening. So the only time that the press would take pictures would be when FDR was standing. And if you look at pictures of FDR at that time period, he was always hanging on to something, usually the car or a podium, whatever might be nearby. And what's interesting is the next morning, FDR was going to McCormick Field, which is our minor league baseball team's field. And there were 20,000 people gathered to see him along the way and then at the field itself. And of course, they couldn't have the president be seen as having polio, and they didn't want him to be seen being in a wheelchair. So what they did was the Secret Service went ahead of the president's car. They literally knocked down part of the right field wall so the car could drive onto the outfield. It made a circle all the way around the field, parked itself at the pitcher's mound, and FDR delivered his address to the people without getting out of the car. And then the car drove off through the hole in the wall on down to Charlotte, where he repeated it all through his campaign.
Thank you. The next question is from Marianne, who asks, how many rooms does the inn have today? Was it ever expanded?
Expanded a couple times. It started out with 150 rooms, and it remained that way until 1984, actually there was a short-lived motel built on the grounds, but we don't count it. It's been torn down, thank goodness. It looked like an early 1950s motel. But what we like to say typically is the rooms, the hotel started with 150 rooms. In 1984, they added the Salmon's Wing, named after Charles Salmons, who owned it at the time. And then in 1988, they added the Vanderbilt Wing. And so today the inn has 510 rooms and has, as I mentioned in the video, 4 restaurants, 2 ballrooms, and several meeting rooms. It now has a world-class spa and is a popular wedding site for many weddings this time of year.
So from Andrea Phillips, what about Jim Crow laws? Were African Americans allowed to stay in the Grove Park Inn before the Civil Rights era?
No, they were not. Fred, see, if you look at a picture of the workmen at the Grove Park Inn, both those who were helping to build the Grove Park Inn and those who were at the Grove Park Inn after it opened, you will find that there were many African Americans employed by the Grove Park Inn, but they were not, probably not often accepted as guests. There may well have been exceptions, but it was not widely known per se. The same would apply to alcohol. The interesting thing is that when the Grove Park Inn opened in 1913, Asheville actually had a prohibition law even before the federal government passed it. But Fred Seeley made it possible for his guests to order moonshine from some of the local distillers. So there was always alcohol available and you could bring your own, but the Grove Park Inn couldn't sell it in the early years of the hotel's history.
I have a few questions here about the inn's owner's relationships to the Vanderbilts and whether or not they ever crossed paths.
One of my pet peeves, I must say, I do not work for the Grove Park Inn. I've written several books. I am their unofficial historian and I curate their collection, but I don't actually work for the Grove Park Inn. So I can sometimes get away with saying things that I wouldn't otherwise. I never understood why in 1988, they named the new wing after George Vanderbilt. George Vanderbilt, as you all know, built the Biltmore House in 1895 here in Asheville, 250 room mansion. And the Grove Park Inn opened up in 1913. George Vanderbilt, if you know much about his life, you know that George Vanderbilt in 1914, when he was at their home in Washington, DC, died from a blood clot after he had his appendix removed. He was actually at home in Washington, DC. The short while between when the inn opened on July of 1913, George Vanderbilt was not on the guest list. I have no doubt that Fred Seeley invited George Vanderbilt, but I think that George Vanderbilt probably never spent a single night at the Grove Park Inn. One thing, it was not his style of furnishing. And for another, he was dead within a year of when the Grove Park Inn opened. And if you have your choice between a hotel room on the north side of Asheville or a 250 room mansion with all your staff of servants, you're going to stay in your own house. So George Vanderbilt probably never stayed at the Grove Park Inn. Edith Vanderbilt, his widow, was a good friend of Fred Seeley, who was the manager of the Grove Park Inn, and they were very close friends. But the reasoning for naming the Vanderbilt wing after George Vanderbilt in 1988 just never has made good sense to me, but they didn't ask me at the time.
So speaking of notable guests, Sandra asks, what were the Obamas' impressions of the inn?
The Obamas loved coming to the Grove Park Inn. The only reason I'm not surprised that they haven't returned is that they get to spend their time in Hawaii. And as nice as Asheville is, we aren't quite the same as Hawaii. The Obamas came twice. Each time he golfed a good part of the time that he was here. Also partook of some of the best barbecue we have at the 12 Bones restaurant in town. And he loves to golf and had a great time golfing here. And I think that accounts for their return trip as well.
Thank you. So Fred Tarver asks, the roof is unusual. What was the thinking behind its design and what is the composition?
The original clay roof, clay tile roof on the main inn, and this is the second roof on the inn, but it is identical to what was put on the first time. Fred Seeley, who was the designer of the inn, he picked the red clay tile so that when you saw the Grove Park Inn from across the valley, from the other side of the French Broad River, and you looked over at the Grove Park Inn with all that granite exterior and the red tile roof, especially in the fall, it blended in perfectly with the fall foliage. So the red tile roof was picked for two reasons. One, the durability of the red tile, which lasted over 100 years before it had to be replaced, and the color that blended in the arts and crafts style with the mountains around it.
And the next question is from Lisa, who asks, who owns the inn today?
The inn is currently owned by the Omni Corporation out of Dallas, Texas. To back up a little bit, in 1955, Charles Sammons bought it. He died in 1988. His wife, Elaine, ran the hotel from a distance, from Dallas, where their home was. Charles Sammons collected hotels like domino, like pieces on a Monopoly board. And he made his fortune in the pharmaceutical business and in telecommunications, insurance. 2009, Mrs. Sammons dies and the Sammons Corporation sells it to basically a company that flipped it called KSL. But in the year 2013, coming up on 10 years now, the Omni Corporation bought it. And so it is now officially known as the Omni Grove Park Inn.
The next question is from Brian. Has the Grove Park Inn ever been damaged by any natural events?
No, short answer. It would take a lot. I've often said in my talks, in the 1950s, when the Grove Park Inn was a shell of a hotel, when people were flocking to motels out on the interstate, if they could have figured out a way to tear down the Grove Park Inn, it might have been torn down in the 50s. But it is built so well, I don't even think a major earthquake. And Asheville's had its share of minor earthquakes. I don't think it will ever be damaged by anything. I think it could withstand a tornado. The clay tile roof is going to withstand hail. It's been through blizzards, coming up on 110 years worth of weather. William Jennings Bryan at the 1913 address said it was built for the ages. And I think he was absolutely right.
So on a similar note, Adair Caperton asked, would you please give more detail about how the amazing feat of building the Grove Park Inn happened without modern tools and machinery?
The amazing feat was Fred Seeley. Fred Seeley was an organizer. He was not a craftsman. He was not an architect. But that man could organize anything. And it was his organization. When they had the groundbreaking in July of 1912, he announced that it was going to open in 1 year. And everybody just thought that was ridiculous. But Fred Seeley was one of those guys that was probably the first on the job and the last to leave every day. First thing he did was he offered workmen, rock masons primarily, but tile layers as well, and carpenters, whatever they were making in town, he offered, and back then they were paid by the day, he offered $1 a day more than anybody else was paying. And luckily, a lot of the workmen who had been in Asheville in the 1890s working on the Biltmore House had liked Asheville enough, and Asheville went through a building boom after the Biltmore House, that they were kept busy. So he was fortunate that Asheville had an ample supply of skilled workmen. And by offering them more money than they were making any place else, he had more than enough help. And then again, the materials, in contrast, the Biltmore House, which you've either seen pictures of or been to, the Biltmore House is built from Indiana limestone. The Grove Park Inn is built from rocks they picked up from Sunset Mountain. So his materials were right there, right at hand. when Grove figured out how much lumber he was going to need, he started his own lumber company because he had lumber land all around Asheville. So Fred Seeley had an ample supply of labor, an ample supply of materials, and he was a taskmaster. And so he organized it, said he was going to open it in 1 year. He missed his deadline by just 1 week.
Kayla Bennett asked, do you have any information on the textile mill or antique car hold at the Grove Park Inn, and if there are any interesting stories about that?
Well, what you're talking about is next door to the Grove Park Inn. I'll try not to make this too long. Even though that Fred Seeley technically worked for his father-in-law, the two men never got along. And so Fred Seeley realized that sooner or later, he and his father-in-law were going to have a major falling out. Fred Seeley did not own the Grove Park Inn. He rented it from his father-in-law. And so Fred Seeley, to sort of give himself an out, he bought from Edith Vanderbilt a weaving enterprise that Edith Vanderbilt had named Biltmore Estate Industries. And this was a weaving of homespun cloth that they used to make men and women's suits from out of wool. And Fred Seeley bought Biltmore Estate Industries from Edith Vanderbilt after George had died in 1914. And he moved the Biltmore Estate Industries onto the grounds of the Grove Park Inn. But he owned it and he renamed it Biltmore Industries. And it was from 1917 on, and they wove cloth and they made furniture and did wood carvings. And this was all next door to the Grove Park Inn. But to be clear, it was never owned by the Grove Park Inn, is not owned by the Grove Park Inn today. It is a separate enterprise. It's owned by a family in Asheville. It is a wonderful place to visit. They have an antique car museum there that will blow you away. They have a museum of their own right, and they have the looms set up so you can see how they wove cloth starting in 1917 there through about 1972. And the five buildings that Fred Seeley built have all been restored. There's a cafe there. Anybody who goes to the Grove Park Inn who doesn't walk next door to Biltmore Industries is really missing a really rare treat. So if you go over, be sure you walk. It's just a walk. You walk out the door of the Grove Park Inn, across the road, and you're on a wooded campus of Biltmore Industries, which is very idyllic.
Thomas White asked, did Thomas Wolfe and F. Scott Fitzgerald ever meet at the Grove Park Inn or Carl Sandburg?
Well, Carl Sandburg came too late, but Thomas Wolfe and F. Scott Fitzgerald were friends, but they were also literary rivals. They were both novelists working for Charles Scribner's, and they were friends to a certain extent. F. Scott Fitzgerald came to Asheville in 1935, and he lived at the Grove Park Inn for most of 1935 and 1936. At that time, Thomas Wolfe was not living at the Grove, living in Asheville. He had moved to New York. But Thomas Wolfe came back to Asheville for a visit, and he and F. Scott Fitzgerald had lunch together in Tryon, of all places. F. Scott Fitzgerald, he had a disastrous love affair at the Grove Park Inn. And when the husband of the woman he was sleeping with was scheduled to come to town, he always had to leave town. So he would either go to the Lake Lure Inn at Lake Lure and hide out there. He would go downtown to the Vanderbilt Hotel and stay there. And sometimes he would go to Tryon to the Oak Hall Hotel and stay there. And so one day in 1936, Thomas Wolfe and his brother drove to Tryon and had lunch together with F. Scott Fitzgerald at the Oak Hall Hotel in Tryon. To the best of my knowledge, they did not meet at the Grove Park Inn, but they did meet. They were friends. They had several other meetings in New York. But that would have been the last time they would have been together. It would have been at the Oak Hall Hotel in Tryon.
From JJS, are there historical or significant gardens on the grounds?
Unfortunately, not anymore. If you look at the original pictures of the Grove Park Inn, they used to have wonderful hiking trails. They had gardens around. In the front of the inn there, before the tennis courts were built, and then later the spa, they had wonderful flower gardens all around the inn. The grounds were fabulous early on. Today there are what I would call plantings around, wonderful shrubbery and stuff, but nothing like what it was in 1913. Its heyday was 1913 until 1929, the Great Depression, and the departure of Fred Seeley sent the Grove Park Inn on a tailspin, and it never really recovered from it as fully as it was. But in that first 20 years, it would have been a fabulous place, the sort of place you would go and stay for a couple of weeks and never feel you had to leave.
The next question is from Donna Shields, who asked to hear more about the huge fireplaces. She thinks she remembers that each of them can hold a wagon full of wood.
Yeah, actually you could park a small car inside these fireplaces. E.W. Grove saw pictures of the Old Faithful Inn in Yellowstone Park. And if you've either seen the postcards of it or been there, right in the middle of the lobby, and it's an open lobby, is this magnificent giant fireplace. And so E.W. Grove said to Fred Seeley, let's have a giant fireplace in the Great Hall. Fred Seeley upped him and said, no, let's have two of them. And as I mentioned in the video, they didn't need, these fireplaces, you can stand up inside them. This was not a medieval castle that depended on the fireplace to keep people warm. These fireplaces were for show only. But they kept roaring fires in them, fires so hot sometimes the guests would have to back away. But the inn didn't depend on fireplaces for heating. There were not fireplaces in the guest rooms. These were fireplaces for social gatherings. And so they built them large, and they are impressive, and they are wonderful, but they really are for show. And today, one of them still burns wood. One of them, switched over to gas, and they use them year round. When it's a cool night in June, tonight, they probably have a fire in one of the fireplaces, and people will pull the rocking chairs up around them. There's just something wonderful about having a fireplace any time of year.
The next question, are there any other ghosts except for the Pink Lady?
No. No reports. Maybe ghosts have territorial privileges, I'm not sure. But no ghosts other than the Pink Lady. A quick side story. Over my more than 35 years of association with the Grove Park Inn, I've dealt with many marketing directors. And one of the marketing directors came to me one time and said, can we tell people that the Pink Lady is really Zelda Fitzgerald? And of course the answer is no, we can't do that, because Zelda Fitzgerald, although she did die in Asheville, a horrible death in a fire, it was not at the Grove Park Inn. But the Grove Park Inn, no, just has the one resident ghost, the Pink Lady.
And from Aaron Rutherford, are there any hidden passageways or rooms in the inn? Has it ever featured a speakeasy?
It would never have had a speakeasy, because both E.W. Grove and Fred Seeley during that era were teetotalers. Neither one of them drank, neither one of them smoked. As far as secret passages, there are ways that the staff can get from one end of the hotel to the other without going through the public areas. They aren't really secret. But there are under the Great Hall, and sometimes, especially if there's a special event going on at the Great Hall at the Grove Park Inn, it gets very crowded, and it's hard to get from one end of the hotel to the other. So it is possible to go downstairs and to traverse from one end of the hotel to the other, coming up at the other end without having to pass through the Great Hall. Is it truly a secret passageway? No, it's just not a public passageway.
And from Betsy, how did the inn manage to remain in the same style over all the years without getting updated?
unfortunately, it did get updated. In the 1950s, 1955, Charles Sammons, who I mentioned earlier, he bought the hotel, bought it sight unseen because he collected hotels. It's just what, that was his hobby. And when you have that kind of money, you can. And I think at one time he owned 20 hotels around the country. And so in the 1950s, he hired a team of decorators who came in and they tried to erase any vestige of the arts and crafts heritage of the Grove Park Inn. They covered up walls with sheetrock and plywood. They tore down the stone pillars. They took the Roycroft furniture and they pushed it out on the front porch and they sold it for $5 a chair. The only pieces that didn't move were those pieces that were too big to move. And so fortunately, some of the big pieces like the 8-foot clock stayed behind. But during the 1950s and early 1960s, they tried to cover up the arts and crafts heritage. And it was in the 1960s and 1970s that Elaine Salmon stepped forward and said, wait a minute. You know, and I have to attribute it to the bicentennial. If you're around in 1976, you know that the country got swept up with antiques, restoring old houses, historic districts, architecture. And so in the 1970s, the Grove Park Inn looked around and said, wait a minute, we are not a mid-century modern hotel. We are not a motel. We are an historic hotel. And so starting in the 1970s through today, they started refurbishing and buying reproductions and authentic antiques. But there was a time period from 1955 until roughly the middle 1970s when the Grove Park Inn tried to hide its arts and crafts heritage rather than to proclaim it as it does today.
So Brian Crutcher asks if you could discuss the Japanese diplomat's intern during World War II.
Yeah. without making it too long, when World War II broke out in late 1941, early 1942, the U.S. government went around the country and it took over several hotels, Grove Park Inn being one of them. And you can read books have been written about this subject. A man by the name of Ike Hall, he was an Oklahoma oil man that for some reason bought the Grove Park Inn out of bankruptcy in like the late 1930s during the Great Depression. And Ike Hall was miserable at the Grove Park Inn, but he was lucky enough to own it when the U.S. government came knocking on the door. And the government basically came in and told Ike Hall they were taking over the hotel, but not for nothing. Ike got paid very handsomely. And what the U.S. government did was they went to Washington, D.C. They arrested all of the German and Japanese diplomats and their families. They put them on a train and they shipped them to the Grove Park Inn. They also froze their American bank accounts and they deducted money from their bank accounts to pay for their room and board at the Grove Park Inn. And so Ike Hall was making out like a bandit, but his hotel was being run by the US government. The German and Japanese government did the same thing in their countries to the American diplomats. So these Japanese and German families were only housed at the Grove Park Inn for a matter of months before the governments quickly worked out a trade where they traded for each other's diplomats. So we sent the Japanese back to Japan, the Germans back to Germany, and they sent the Americans back to America, and the Grove Park Inn went back to Ike Hall. The U.S. government then rented it back from Ike Hall again, and for a short while, they actually used it as a prisoner of war camp and put barbed wire and guards around it, and they actually had interred in there Japanese officers who had been captured. And then toward the end of the war, they transformed it again. They took down the barbed wire, and this time they had it as an R&R station for returning officers, American officers. And so after your tour of duty was up, you could be shipped back to the Grove Park Inn and you could stay at the Grove Park Inn for 2 weeks for free with your wife. And for that reason, there were several weddings held at the Grove Park Inn, because a lot of these soldiers had their fiancés transported to the Grove Park Inn. They got married at the Grove Park Inn and then spent a 2-week honeymoon at the Grove Park Inn before they went home. And then shortly after that, the inn went back to Ike Hall, who struggled to keep it open from 1948 until Charles Sammons bought it in 1955.
The next question, Deanne understands that the elevators were contained within the fireplaces to help muffle the noise from the machinery. Is this accurate?
Very accurate. Fred Seeley, as in his previous career working for his father-in-law, traveled a great deal and stayed at hotels where he was kept awake at night by the sounds of the elevators going up and down. And so when he was designing the Grove Park Inn, he had those fireplaces made extra wide so that one end of the fireplace they could put the elevator shaft in. The elevators were made by the Otis Elevator Company, very famous. They're very small, 3 people at a time, maybe, and they are manually operated, so you can't operate them yourself, but they're still functional. And so if you go to the Grove Park Inn today, even if you're not staying on the 3rd through the 6th floors of the main inn, you can still get in the elevator, go all the way up to the 5th floor, look around, hoping to see the pink lady, and you can get in the elevator and go back down. So, but you're exactly right. They were put there to muffle the sound so people wouldn't be disturbed at night by the noise.
Okay, and we have time for just one more question. This one comes from Caitlin Grimes, who asks if there are any interesting stories about governors or state officials visiting the Grove Park Inn.
Well, none to top that of FDR. There were obviously lots of famous people, and I will tell you this. There's a famous picture taken in front of the Grove Park Inn in 1918, and as you're looking across the picture, it's, you know, some names that should be familiar to you: Harvey Firestone, Thomas Edison, Henry Ford, and Fred Seeley. It was not at all unusual for governors, senators, capitalists, famous people to come and stay at the Grove Park Inn, primarily because when they went to check out, and this was during the Fred Seeley era, 1913 to 1927, they generally found they had a zero written on the bottom of their bill. Fred Seeley would allow these people to stay for free, because he knew that along with Henry Ford and Thomas Edison and Harvey Firestone and FDR came reporters. And that picture I was just telling you about ran on the front page of newspapers across the country. Fred Seeley got more publicity out of having famous people come to the Grove Park Inn than he did through any amount of advertising he could have paid for. One of his famous guests and good friends was Eleanor Roosevelt, who stayed several times and would write about her stays at the Grove Park Inn because she kept coming back because it was no charge to her. So there were lots of them who came, but I think the most interesting story is how Fred Seeley used those opportunities to promote the Grove Park Inn.
Great, thank you all very much for the questions. And thank you, Mr. Johnson, for the presentation. That was so excellent. This presentation has been recorded and will be uploaded to the museum's YouTube channel. There's a link to the channel in the chat. And
thank you, Alexandra. And yes, thank you so much, Bruce, for such an incredible program, this behind the scenes look at the Grove Park. I miss it so much. It makes me want to go right out and go up there right now. What a wonderful treat for all of us. Thank you.
Thank you.
And thank you to all those of you who joined us this evening. We hope that you enjoyed it and that you will join us for our next History and Highballs happening on the evening of July 8th at 7 p.m. We will be hearing about the new version, the latest version of the Lost Colony production. Hope you have a great rest of your evening, and we will see you all soon. Take care, everybody.